always happen because not every scripture is, you know, brings goosebumps. Try to read Leviticus, you will see. But you are commanded to read the word every single day. Meditate on the day, on the word day and night. So if the builder, for example, wanted to build this building, and for each brick he has to feel sensations, this building would not be finished. Because you drop one brick, rabra kalabaha. When will you finish? But the builder keeps on just putting one brick on top of the other. One brick on top of the other. In the end, he has a building. So as you are reading your word, you are building yourself a spiritual house to dwell in. Amen. So he says, Joshua, read this word. And it's one of those verses that are rare in the Bible where you find prosperity and success in one sentence. And he says, when you read this word, then your success and prosperity will come. You won't have to chase another person or affiliate with other people for you to be prosperous. It's in the word. The word is the deposit of God's power, his nature and character. It's hidden in the word. And in Colossians 3, verse 16, Paul says this: let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, in all teaching, and admonishing one another in psalms and spiritual songs, or in hymns and spiritual songs, with grace in your heart. If my word abides in you, she quoted it, I think, earlier on here. We are supposed to eat the word, to live in the word. Amen.
Amen.
Because the word hides the essence of God, its character and nature. I cannot say, Lord, talk to me when my Bible is closed.
Yeah. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So if you're a Joshua here and you're in this season, I don't know if whether you are into a transition or something else, but either way, life brings transitions, you know. There's a time when you have to move to the next season of your life. And God calls us to be secure in who he made us to be. Don't try to be a copycat. Don't try to be something that you are not. Secondly, just know that you have the assurance of my presence. I did not create you because I was trying to find my creative edge. I did not create you because I was lonely, I was bored. I did not create you because I was insecure, I needed you to tell me how big I am. He created us because he wanted to share himself with us. We are meant to be the vessels of his presence and glory here on earth. So he creates them in chapter 1 of Genesis, and we see him in Genesis 1. He is the God that is not even battling to create anything. He just preaches creation into existence. And then he says, let us make man in our own image, after our own likeness. And then he inhabits us. And then he says, take this perfection and project it to the world. Go and flood the earth with my glory. And then Paul looks at this and he says, you know what, we carry this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the excellence of the power may not be of us, but of him. And he takes this illustration in his time, because what would happen then is that the people would have jars, precious jars, and then they would put their treasure in there. When the thief breaks in, he takes the jar with the treasure. And so they decided, let's just use clay jars and then hide our treasure in the clay jars. When the thief comes in, he sees a clay jar that is not so attractive and he ignores it, but that's where the treasure is. And so Paul says, my brethren, consider your calling, that not many wise, according to the world, were called, not many strong, but he chose the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, the weak to confound the strong. And so God has placed his glory, his presence and power in you, because the creation waits with eager expectation to see the manifestation of the sons of God. So we are deployed here as ambassadors of Christ to project his character and nature. We are not here to decorate the earth. He would have placed us in a museum. We are here to flood the whole earth with his glory. And if we are sitting with his glory, there's a problem. There are three boys in Daniel chapter 3, you know them. Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. And they are in a culture that is shaped for them to compromise their faith. In chapter 1, Daniel says, you know what, I resolved in my heart that I would not eat from the king's table. Because if I eat what the king gives me, I'm going to compromise also in other areas of my life.
Yeah.
So I won't settle for the demonic diet. Give me vegetables and water. And then they gave them, and he says, test us after 10 days. And then they tested them, and the word of God says that they were 10 times better than those that were eating from the king's table. In chapter 3, the king, makes a statue for himself, an image for himself, is insecure. Because when you're insecure, you make yourself look bigger than you are. And then they say, you know what, we are going to gather people here. And when they hear the music, they are going to bow and worship. Music is powerful. So they play their music. And then while everybody was there worshiping, I don't know how they saw these three boys because they were supposed to be worshiping. But they say, there are three boys. There are three Hebrew boys that you promoted. They're not worshiping. And the boys were just standing there. Everybody's there worshiping. Rah, rah, bah, 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 Robocop stuff. And then the king, Nebuchadnezzar, is like, guys, maybe you did not hear me. I said, when the music plays, DJ, when the music plays, you guys are going to bow and worship me. So I'll give you another chance. You guys, when you hear the music, you bow and worship me. And the DJ plays the music, and the boys are just standing there. And then he says, okay, we will kindle the fire 7 times and throw you in there. I don't know if it will make any difference, because fire is fire. Whether it's 1 time or 7 times, you will burn. That's just like saying, you know what, I'll shoot you 5 times in the head. One is enough. I think if you shoot me 1 time, I'll die. If you do it 4 more times, I think you're just being rude. So he says, we'll throw you into the fire. And then they bring these guys that are supposed to throw them into the fire. And when they get there, these men that were carrying them got bent and they died. And the three boys did not. And their ropes, because they tied them, and the ropes got bent. And this guy called Nebuchadnezzar, he sees something going on in the fire. And he threw in 3 people, but he sees the 4th one. Remember the gift of his assurance, the presence of God, that I'm with you. And then he sees the 4th man walking there, and he says, I see a 4th man. And he's like the son of man. It's not Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego who say we see him. It's the king. Yeah. You see, God gets more glory when it's the non-believers who say we see their God. Amen. In the midst of the culture of idolatry. And then they say, but we see something unique about their God. Yes. And the guys are there. And then I don't know how they did it, but then they must, because it says that they were walking through the fire. So they must have called each other out, like, Abednego. And then they all stood up and started walking in the fire. And then Jesus, I don't know how he did it, but I think there must have been a conversation in heaven, like, Daddy, can I go and join my people down there? And the father's like, no, it's not yet time. Wait, it's not yet time. It's not yet time for the Messiah to come. But just go and come back. And then he goes there, and then he walks with them in the fire. Yeah. And Nebuchadnezzar sees him, and he's like, hey, guys, let's honor this God. The rest who are worshiping you can continue worshiping me, but the God of these guys, don't mess with him.
Yeah.
Anybody that messes with him is going to die. And these guys were promoted. But they did not celebrate the promotion, because they were promoted in a culture that was meant for them to compromise their faith in God. Yeah. So be careful sometimes what you celebrate on earth. After the promotion, these guys went home. I'm finishing now. After the promotion, the guys went home. And they just continued with their lives. Just like David, when the anointing came, you remember the anointing coming through Samuel? When he was anointed, he went back to the fields. You know, he didn't open a church or start a ministry.
Yeah.
He went back and took care of the sheep. And then he's just minding his own business until he goes to this battlefield sometime, delivering cheese. He was a cheese boy. So he goes there. and then he finds that there are men that went to fight, like warriors, even his own brothers. And then there would be this giant who comes up. And then every morning he would come up and he's like, guys, anyone willing to fight me? And the Israelites would go back in fear. They were dressed for battle, but they were not ready to fight. Christians are so dressed for battles, but they don't fight. We spend so much time in this house making a lot of noise and a lot of smoke, but we don't fight when it matters. We don't represent him. We don't reflect him when it matters most. So for 40 days, Goliath comes and he's like, guys, anyone wants to fight? In the morning, and no one shows up, and then he goes back and he has his breakfast. And then he comes back in the evening. No, he doesn't say anything about breakfast though, but so I'm telling the story, it's okay. So in the evening, he comes back and he says, guys, anyone wants to fight for 40 days? Morning, evening, and if you multiply that, that's 80 times. insulting God and his people. Until this boy shows up. Until this boy shows up and he hears him insulting the armies of God. And he's like, who is this guy? Who is this guy? You see, once you are in a place where God is dishonored and you start asking questions, maybe you're just anointed to deal with the problem. And David gets there and he's like, what's going on here? And then they tell him, and they tell him that whoever will fight this giant and kill him, he will get the girl and his family will be exempted from paying taxes. And then David, and I think the word gets to Saul even before David gets there. And they tell him that, Saul, there's a young man here who is asking about the giant and the people. And by the time David gets there, he's no longer asking questions. He has the answer. He's like, I'll go and fight this guy. You see, when you start asking questions, you start to carry a burden for the things that God is burdened by. What breaks his heart breaks your heart. What excites his heart excites your heart. And so David gets there, he's like, Saul, I'm the answer to my own question. I'll go fight this guy. And then Saul gives him a coat of mail, and David says, I know, these things are heavy. Give me my sling, and he picks up 5 rocks. And then throws one, and then the guy falls and dies, and he cuts his head. And then he comes to Saul, and he's like, is this him? And Saul says, yeah, that's him. And you read about the tribe of Saul, the tribe of Benjamin. You can read about this in Judges chapter 16. It says that they were left-handed, and these guys would throw a sling, and they would never miss. But Saul had given up that privilege. He comes from a fighting generation, but he had just lost all of that. The anointing that was flowing on his head was not as valued as it should have been in his heart. He despised the anointing of God. Another boy showed up. But before David showed up, his brother is like, what are you doing here? I know your naughtiness. You know, he came to fight, but he's not willing to fight. They are bragging about being close to the king, but they're not anointed. You know, I'm with the sheep, but I'm anointed. David didn't say that. We are busy bragging about, you know what, I'm close to the man of God. But you're not anointed. And those that you are sidelining are actually the ones that are carrying the anointing. They will show up and ask the right questions, and you will feel insecure. Because they will expose you that, you know what, we came with solutions here, and you have been here for years, 40 days, and nothing. I don't know how we got here, but we are supposed to talk about 4 points. Be secure. Be sure that God is with you. Endure. And be pure. You need to place value on the word of God. You need to value the word of God. You see, this is the only book that you read with the author present to interpret it to you.
Yes. Amen.
This is the only book that you read, and he sits there and he's like, yeah, what I meant there was. And then he tells you, and maybe the goosebumps might come. But the more you eat the word of God, the more your appetite for his word grows. You know, the word of God is an acquired taste. It's not so easy for some people to read, but the more you do it, every time, over and over again, a bit of light comes up. David says that the entrance of your word brings light. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The word of God is active, it's sharper than any double-edged sword. It cuts deeper to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and it even descends the intents of our hearts. We place value on the word of God. So I want to close with this. Intimacy precedes ministry. In Mark 3, verse 13, it says, Jesus went up on a mountain and he called to himself that those that he himself wanted, and send them out to preach. So to be with him and then to send them out to preach, we are called to be with him first and then go out and preach, because if you don't know who he is, you will project a wrong revelation of who he is. Who do people say I, the Son of Man, am? Some say you are Jeremiah, some say you are Isaiah, some say you are John the Baptist, but who do you say I am? And Simon says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Identification, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And he's like, you're not Simon. You are Peter. You are Cephas, meaning the rock. And upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. You see, it is in the context of relationship with him that you discover who you are, just as you discover who he is. It flows from the Father, not from the opinions of people. And then he says, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So that is identity. Security, authority. And that happens in the context of intimacy relationship with him. If you want to be effective and successful and prosperous, you're not going to be prosperous and effective because you are governed by the opinions of your culture. You are governed by the word of God. Joshua, let not this word depart from your mouth. Let the word shape your conversations. When you speak, let the word come out and not your issues and tissues. Is it okay if we pray? All right, let's rise and pray. For some of you, this does not make sense today. But a season will come where there will be a transition. Some of you are called into ministry, or at least you sense that you're called into ministry. If only you can be sure, can be secure, you can endure and be pure, you will succeed, you will prosper. And some of you have no idea what this guy is just talking about. Or some of you are like, God cannot use me. Look, man, God used a donkey to speak. The rod, a dead thing, could actually become a snake. There's a guy called Lazarus. He was dead. If God can use a dead man, how about you? So in whatever state or in whatever season of your life, I pray that God may help you to do what you came here to do, to live out what he brought you here to live out. He didn't bring you here to be a monument. He brought you here to be a movement. Amen. You're not an ornament, you're an instrument. Amen. In the hands of the Master.
Amen.
So Lord, we pray this morning in the name of Jesus that, Father, may you bless your people. To the discouraged, Father, may you bring hope and courage. Father, to those that are struggling right now, Father, in whatever reason or in whatever thing that is causing them, Lord, to even doubt your presence in their lives, we ask that your favor and grace and your mercy, my Lord God, may be upon them. Father, you called others here, Lord God, for your glory, for your ministry, for your work. We pray that, Father, we value you before we value work. That we sit at your feet and receive that one thing that Mary received, which could not be taken away from her. And we don't be preoccupied with doing things for you that we don't have time to be with you. So help us, my God, even through these exams and all of that, and all the things that we are doing now in this time, may we glorify you in whatever state, in whatever condition, in whatever circumstance, that your name may be lifted up in our lifetime. That we too may speak like Jesus and say, it's finished when the time comes. That we speak like Paul and say, you know what, I've run my race, I've kept the faith. Whatever you call each person here, my God, whatever sphere of grace you place them in, I pray that they glorify you in their lifetime. That you be exalted in our lives, because Christ is exalted. You gave him the name that is above every name. That in the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven, things on earth, and things under the earth. And that every tongue confess that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. We pray that we may see him exalted, we may see him glorified, even in our lifetime. Lord, we just dismiss your people with a blessing from you, and we ask that, Lord God, may we just continue representing you with honor, with integrity, that in all things Christ may be glorified. May we remain in him just as he remains in us. You said that he who loves you will obey your commandments, and you and the Father will come and make your home in him. Lord, we are not hotels, we are homes. You don't check in and check out, you live in us. We have the gift of your presence. We are the residents of your presence. And so that is a privilege, that is a blessing, that is an honor. May we value it. May we value your presence, may we value your word. In the name of Jesus. Thank you so much for your people, their time and attention. God bless you. Amen.
God more than that, we are welcome to. Can we appreciate God? Can we appreciate God?